Welcome everyone to what I think will be a very interesting discussion. It is a really rare thing to be able to see this kind of industry interaction with a state funding organization in a public place. This is an excellent treat, I hope it will be. if it's terrible, I'll be doing a lot of this. So we should start with a round of introductions. Do you guys want to introduce yourself, or should I attempt to do everyone in a row?
I won't put the pressure on you. So my name is Megan Summers. I have been working in the Brisbane games industry now for almost 9 years. 6 years ago, I started a small company with my best friend called Screwtape Studios, and we are currently working on our first PC game, Damsel.
Mark Fludder, I'm the general manager of Spunge Games. Prior to Spunge, we started about 3 years ago. Prior to that, I spent the best part of 10 years running the Queensland government's digital entertainment strategy. So I had a lot to do with supporting the games industry back in the console days. So that's me.
I'm Christy, I'm the chair of games at SAE. Overseeing games across Australia and Dubai, and I'm the director of Universe Creation 101, in which I create commission independent projects for installations and apps. And I'm new to Brisbane. I've been here for 2 years, 2.5 years now, and before that was in Melbourne, in which I was commissioned to run events like Transmedia Victoria, getting the film industries and game industries to work with each other.
I'm Morgan Jeffers, founder and creative director at Defiant Development. Defiant Development's been running for 6 years. We have 20 staff, and we're a 100% owned Queensland-owned and run independent game studio.
I'm Tracy Vieira. I'm the CEO of Screen Queensland. I have another number of hats outside of Screen, so I'm also on the board of Q Music, the board of the RSPCA. As the CEO of Spring Queensland, we are a government-owned company. Our core responsibilities are really all screen platforms, and I've been there almost 2.5 years.
I'm Jo Dillon. I work with Tracy at Spring Queensland, and my job is head of development and production, which basically means that I look after investment into content for the screen, whatever it is, and so for the purposes of this and this discussion, that includes games. I have also been relatively new to Brisbane and to Screen Queensland, and have been in my role for about 2 years.
I'm John Passfield. I've been making games since the '90s, so for a while. mostly focusing right now on Apple Watch and mobile games, and I've dipped my toe into the corporate world, doing some gamification, sort of user experience and VR work, which has been fun.
Hi, I'm Cheryl, one of the co-founders and directors of a company called Prideful Sloth. We were here a while ago in around GFC time. We left Brisbane, went overseas, got some experience and met some wonderful people over there, came back after we saved up some money to set up our studio here because much better weather than the UK. So we've been back for about a year and a half now, stood up the company about a year ago.
And I'm Nicole Staff. I'm the mum of the family game dev team, Disparity. We're based in Noosa, and we've been around for about 4 years now, so I'm pulling over.
And I am Lee May, and I'm the co-host of ZedGames, which is a community radio program about gaming. And I'm beginning to suspect that the reason I'm up here is because my mother got in contact with the Make-A-Wish Foundation. So why don't we kick things off? Chrissy and Joe, can we talk about the kind of funding that is presently available for games through Screen Queensland? Just broadly, would mind.
Okay, so I think the first thing to say is that in coming into my role, and certainly very much with the support of Tracy and
screen, or what makes the content for the screen, whichever way you want to kind of look at it. So in kind of answering that question, what I want to say is that our funding is available really without any kind of a barrier when it comes to what kind of a platform we're making it for. But really needs to be requested in a way that's appropriate to the kind of platform that you're making it for, the size of your audience, and the budgets that go with that audience. So we invest in the development of content for the screen and in production of content for the screen. Now, in saying that, I'm probably not speaking your language.
I was just about to offer to translate.
Yeah, because I was actually going to bring someone with me from my team who was going to translate.
So when screen,
that would be really helpful.
When Australian screen agencies say development, they mean pre-production, and when they say production, they mean development.
You see, so it's basically all French. But I think that kind of speaks to some of the, I think, learnings that we have obviously got ahead of us, and it speaks to how important this conversation is. And, you know, we don't come here with any kind of sense that we're going to tell you anything, actually, other than what the status quo is, and to express an openness to talk with you, to learn from you, and to work with you. And I think that's a really brilliant example of, you know, the journey that we've got to go on. But essentially, the willingness is there, and the funding is there. But obviously, we kind of need to perhaps communicate that slightly differently, and also to look at sort of funding sources that support particular parts of our industry in particular sectors. And games, I think, is one of those sectors that really looks very much like it needs our attention. The other part of funding that is available, just to kind of round that off, is travel and marketing funding, which again, I think in our eligibility, I know Mark very kindly looked at our funding guidelines and kind of put a line through them.
I left a couple of words.
Probably the amount.
the dollar amount.
The dollars.
But seriously, very helpfully kind of just pointed out where we were communicating things in a slightly different way to the way that the games industry speaks about its work. But the essentials are these, that we do have a modest amount of money to support people to go and be part of international conferences, international markets, and where they're starting out in their career, domestic markets and conferences. And we have a budget that's available for people to apply to as a grant to go and take part in those kinds of markets and events. So those are sort of like, I suppose, the two sides of it. We also run a number of initiatives and actually haven't looked at an initiative in the games space in the couple of years that I've been in my job. But again, we're looking after funding across a wide range of screen content, and so, you know, that's very much something that we kind of need to look at probably within a broader conversation about our overall funding and how we allocate it. But I think that that's probably a picture of what we offer. I can give you some more details within that if you need it.
Can we just get the just the basic amounts attached to each of those funds?
Yes. Okay, marketing and travel. If you're traveling overseas and there's one of you, it's up to $5,000. If there's more than one of you, it's $7,500. And what I should say is that in all cases, when we fund things, we don't fund 100%. We expect either the applicant or a market entity to bring some money to the table as well. We try and be as flexible about that as possible, and towards the sort of lower end where we're grant funding things, you know, obviously we're not expecting people to bring much. But when it gets into production investment and into the bigger end of town, or
$1,000 for travel domestically inside of Australia, $5,000 for one person, $7,500 for more than one person for international travel. Development investment, or I'm now going to call pre-production investment, we would go up to $50,000 for development investment and what we call late stage development investment, but I don't know what that would be called in your world.
We'd probably call it prototype and then pre-production is the two steps.
Okay,
is
so
the under development.
This is brilliant. I should come here more often.
This is working out already.
So for the prototype, up to 50,000, and pre-production, up to 40,000. Again, to reflect the fact that as things get more and more developed and closer to going out into the market and selling, that we expect and reflect in the amount of money that we can put in, that the marketplace and private investment will also come to the table in incrementally larger numbers as things get closer. Okay, production investment, aka development investment. with the range of funding that we have, I mean, we're funding things from the sort of smallest web series right through to Thor. and so our funding kind of really is kind of very much a concertina and very much is adapted to fit the size of the project. But the upper limit of it, if that's the figure that's useful, is $850,000.
Thank you very much for that. I think for most people here, that already has like made their night. just knowing actually about the kind of funding that is available.
It's good culture as well. And we have screen culture for events, festivals and so on too, yes. Yeah. So we do actually currently support 32 different things under our screen culture banner, which range from, really there's a full gamut, it can be anything from a games event to a virtual reality event through to a short film festival or a major film festival. And so, and they're all across Australia, all across the state. I mean, last week, actually through to this week, was we're out in Winton. About the weekend before that, we're up in Cairns. We've got almost 32, so almost something every week in terms of support that we're putting some money into.
It's minimum 2,000?
Minimum 2,000 that we supply to any of those events. So, and again, they can scale up to 700,000.
I should also, just to let you know, Tracy and Joe, you seem like you're a little bit defensive. Everyone here wants to be your friends.
That's a bit cool. Actually, I genuinely don't feel that way.
That's good.
I just kind of don't quite have the linguistic ability to communicate.
You're speaking like a native already.
I'm talking about news.
Nice.
So, but and actually, one thing I want to just add to that too, and I'm going to continue the thanks. But we launched. We've been going through a major change in terms of being a screen agency, and we really want to sort of lead the way in Australia in terms of really embracing all of the new platforms and technologies and so on that are out there. So, we launched earlier this year. Something with SBS in terms of doing the Australia's first virtual reality series. We've done the first big deal in terms of creating content with YouTube. We're doing stuff with Ivy. We did the first sort of feature film with Stan. So we're really passionate about moving into what we think is really contemporary screen, and that includes games. And the conversation, I met with Ashley at the VR event, and we started to have a bit more of a conversation. We talked about games, and at that point we'd already started some discussions with people in the games industry, and it was because in looking at
we've made all of these changes and launched all these new programs, and really the thing that has been left to last is games. And that's probably because, in terms of our experiences, and a lot of us are from industry, from screen industries, it's probably the area we've had
non-games screen.
Yeah, non-games. I'm about to say that. Yeah, so we will really acknowledge that this is not where expertise in our team currently sits. But that's not going to be a barrier to us getting the mix right. And Joe and I have committed to really having these conversations, and we've done quite a few, and this is really the last big one, I think, before we start to try and make some recommendations. And what we've identified is that what we have isn't working. You guys don't know about what we have, people aren't coming through the door, and so there's some barrier to entry, and I think it's more than language. It's about really understanding what is the full gamut of games, and you know, and again, I've had the experience of getting to go into some of the businesses and actually experiencing the games may not be what I perceive as a mum of a five-year-old. My games are about, you know, learning to read and angry birds. So, you know, there's a lot, and we really own that we've got a lot to learn, and we've really appreciated and appreciate tonight really to have this conversation. What we're looking to do is to take everything we've heard, and we'll hear tonight as well, about, you know, what are those barriers, or what are the things that are going to make the differences in your businesses? What are the things that are going to enable you to grow if that's what you want to do? And, you know, we want to make sure that we have a really strong and vibrant industry that's collaborative and that is really sort of making strides in terms of the content and the innovation that's happening within this industry. And so, you know, as part of going forward, we want to make sure what we have works, but also we want to make sure that we're resourcing it right, both in terms of staffing, but also financially. We want to make sure we get that mix right. So this is, for us, is, yeah, not defensive at all. In fact, we're very much open books, and we're wanting you to sort of tell us the story so that we can make sure we get it right.
And also getting to know you as well, as people, because I think if I was in a room where the audience was made up of the Queensland screen industry as regards feature film producers and writers and people working in television, I would know everybody in the room, but I look around and I know a few people, or I've met a few people, and I think, you know, we really want to kind of change that as well and just kind of get to know you guys a bit better and sort of open up those conversations, not just with ourselves, but with our team more broadly.
Yeah. That's really awesome. That's fantastic to hear. So why don't we just start by, I think a show of hands from the panel, and then I guess the room as well. Who has worked on a team that has actually managed to receive funding from Screen Queensland?
So, yeah. That's better than I expected.
Yeah, that's
well, literally, yeah. I was going to say, it's been the opportunity for you. You've been very well with Squats in the past, but you have been active over this period. So.
Yeah, I knew what that number was going to be like, so like, I knew it was going to be fine. I'm going to guess, though, that that's mostly going to be the travel expenses and marketing. Would that be a fair assessment from hands that were up? Yeah, probably.
Except for me. You could.
We got funding this year for me to get over to GDC. I think you mentioned the Diaz in the audience, so thank you for all your help in putting up with this. Which really was such a great thing. This is the first time I've ever been. I jokingly, I think, said maybe wants to send a producer to GDC. So just make it last. So yeah, it was lovely for us as a company to go meet a heap of suppliers, as well as meet new people that work in the industry, start talking with other, you know, other publishers, etc. So it was beneficial.
It's a joke that went totally over my head.
Oh no, we're both producers.
Also, producer isn't quite the same as producer.
Yeah,
either.
No, I didn't.
That's what we're tuning into then.
Which is why when I first did the form, it's like, do you want a producer statement? It's like, what's a producer statement? They don't mean a schedule, right? So, because again, the terminology is very different. And so, yeah, I'd only heard about it through Tim Dawson and Nicole along the way. So it was a word of mouth sort of mysterious thing to me that it existed, but it was great that it, you know, I got access to it. And when I was like, filling out the application, I said to Nicole, what is this producer's statement? So she's like, here's something I did. So it gave you that knowledge sharing of what does it actually mean, what does it do? So I was, you know, I got help to finalize it and get through. And you know, there's a few things like what a market ready concept was. I think the application needed three of them. I took my best shot and attached what I had. It was apparently enough, which is awesome, thank you. But you know, there's things like that that were very ambiguous to me as questions, but you know, we got there, so.
Yeah, that's exactly what we need to know. And it's funny, like, you know, John was just saying this the other day, I remember having a meeting, like up until recently, GDC wasn't on our list of, you know, conferences and events. And yet here we are saying, you know, games, and yet GDC wasn't on there. So, you know, and so, you know, we want to have those conversations. And also, you know, just because something's not on there doesn't necessarily mean we won't support it. We, in terms of, again, film, have sent people to Los Angeles to undertake a series of meetings because it's right for their different productions that they're doing at that moment. And it's not a market, per se, which is what we normally support people going to. And so, you know, we sort of need that information, and we need, you know, and the irony is I've actually been to GDC in 2005, like, when I was in a different job, and it hadn't occurred to me even, having even done that, that we should be having that on that list. So we need to know what are those things and where to get it, because there's no barrier to us adding things onto them. We have the flexibility and you know, we have the sort of desire to sort of meet the needs of the industry. So that input for us is really critical.
Can I give away a secret?
Sure.
Like, applying to any screen agency, it doesn't start when you send the application in. Like, you should be having all these conversations in the months before you put the application in, because screen agencies are incredibly helpful in terms of answering these questions up front. You can organise a meeting and say, so this is what we want to do. And they can help with the translation side of things, and they're incredibly amenable to doing so. You don't have to try and work it all, like, you don't have to try and work it all out and submit a form on the date that it says it's due and hope that that's got the right things in it. You should already know that it's got the right things in it because you've had the conversation.
That's a really important thing to say. We really invite people to have those conversations with us. It's so much better for everybody, actually, if we can have those conversations before an application comes in rather than after an application comes in, because we can just be a lot freer about what we can talk about. There's no kind of, you know, it's, at the end of the day, we do have to report back to government, and so there is a certain element of needing to have probity in what we do and fairness in what we do, and the creation of a level playing field and the reporting back is really important. But so let's park that and go, prior to all of that, we're human beings that can have a conversation, and it's much easier to have the conversation in the context of, hey, I'm thinking about applying, rather than I have applied, because at that point it's, you know, potentially coaching someone into
how to apply or assessment process.
So yeah, always kind of get in touch with us before you apply. We can talk you through stuff, and as you know, as we said, you know, you can tell us what's working for you or what is working for you. And that's much easier to deal with before anybody gets into any kind of a process where it all becomes formal, and for good reasons, a little bit more difficult to have those kinds of conversations as broadly or as candidly as you'd want to.
Just what would the leading time be? So, for example, there's quite a lot of people about to go to PAX and GCAP, which is coming up. Tony can tell us exactly the dates, I'm sure. Is that November?
1 and 2 November for GCAP, 4, so 5, 6 PAX.
Okay, so plenty of time then. 6 weeks before you want to travel.
6 weeks before.
Yeah.
And so that's obviously...
That's when the application is to yes, the conversations
okay.
need to happen.
Before so yeah. Ronnie's going to be talking to you guys very soon.
Yeah.
I think that is part of it, is that obviously, you know, with the film industry, they have that social element. They are, you know, people in film know to approach Screen Queensland, they know to approach the government about this, but the games industry, we don't train ourselves to look to the government for money at the moment.
There are some good reasons for that.
Okay,
because internationally, things were taken away and given. Yeah. So I definitely think for some people, it's this idea that it doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. No one has it. Why would I even look? Except for Victoria. It's like everyone. But I also don't think that people understand that in Victoria, they have a lot of funding, but the people who run those funding bodies are also constantly talking to applicants.
Yes.
And Clara may know the applicants, but she's also spending tens of weeks before exactly the same way. And I think some of it may be because there isn't that interpersonal, or even just maybe seeing an event. So there's a fear when you're giving over your baby and asking for money with that,
yes.
with people that you may not know. But it is exactly the same in Victoria. It's people are asking questions to the last day of application. They may be people that have... There are lots of people who leave their applications maybe to the last day because they know Clara a little too well. But it's I don't think this is being... We're being asked to do something right now with you guys that isn't already happening
yeah.
and isn't being proven to work. Victoria, I don't think, would be working if there was as much communication between both the game developers and the screen agency. And I definitely think that, yeah, email, ask questions. That's what we've, I think, always done. Kieran has been extreme. We weren't able to get funding for the project that we're working on now, but Kieran did absolutely everything he could, bar lying on the application, which it was very close for us to do because
yeah.
we were past prototype funding stage.
Yeah.
The funding that was there was prototype funding. We were working on one other thing that we were prototyping. He was trying to help us.
Yeah.
It just, at the time, didn't work. I don't think Screen Queensland is an agency that is at all trying not to give us money.
Mm.
It's definitely, there's people there working hard all the time. And there's a slight misunderstanding, maybe, between at what points people, when they're making games, will need money. Based on what at what points when getting ready to produce a film. But other than that, it's those small things is really for me and my company anyway. Where we are at a 6-year company about to release our biggest game. Funding help would have been amazing. But what was there? People were trying to get us that funding, no matter what, around what was there.
This is something John touched on as well, which is that Screen Queensland kind of hides their back under a bushel in this regard. In that, we've got the Screen Australia logo on the front of our game
mm-hmm.
because they're an enterprise funder, client, and the fund that went away.
Mm-hmm.
But Screen Queensland helped us as well, and Screen Queensland don't ask for any trumpet block, like, you know, we're not trying
to...
Wait,
no,
it's like that now.
Well, it's funny, you've touched on the border, because I told you earlier I'm extremely competitive. and it's interesting. I mean, as I said, we're really fairly new to it, and I can't talk to whatever Spring Queensland or the PFTC did historically. What we're doing is very much looking forward, and certainly I've had a look at what Film Victoria are doing and how that's worked. But equally, we don't necessarily want to do exactly what they're doing. We want to make sure it works for the people that are here and for the industry that are here and to grow the Queensland industry. And so, that's why it's so integral to have these conversations, because we want to make sure what we're doing going forward actually is really relevant and works for the people here.
I said it was a bit cheeky. I did put together a slide showing all the tweets that Film Victoria made about games in the last 6 months, and all the tweets about Screen Queensland made. and you probably don't need the difference in numbers.
Yes.
But there's a lot of so I think Film Victoria definitely does acknowledge the industry, but not only Victoria, but also Australia. They follow me on Twitter, follow every game developer, so they've got that real knowledge about what's going on. The GDAA will retweet, everyone will retweet what's happening, so they've definitely got a profile. Something that isn't really there with Screen Queensland, but it can be there.
I think that we would acknowledge that as well.
Mm.
I think they are doing some great things with Victoria,
absolutely.
And in a way that we're not,
we'll start
not blind to that at all.
Everyone will follow Screen Queensland tonight. And you'll know they're off this conference, so you can follow that.
you'll be seeing the right to. Great way to get information.
Yeah, the cultural shift is there's one of the things that worked really well, I think, in the early days of Film Victoria is they had Fred Giblin was the first. He was the first one, and he was very
active.
But the work that he did in terms of spending time with everyone, as we spoke about, the internal champion is really important.
Absolutely.
As well, and I think if you've got that to a degree, but having that dedicated person and listening to them internally and getting them speaking to everyone externally as well is critical for that cultural shift. But I think another aspect of the cultural shift. On the side of games is games, they haven't seen themselves as being arts funded, as arts. I think a lot of developers have looked for startup funding and technology support and all that sort of stuff, and there's a paradigm shift of like, oh, we are an art form.
Well, it's interesting you say that too. So one of the other things that we've done since we've been there is we've gone broader than just being part of art. So the stuff we've done with YouTube has included Advance Queensland, and it's co-funded. We're doing stuff with Tourism and Events Queensland where it's relevant and co-funding. We have a roundtable now with Advance Queensland, State Development, ourselves, and Tourism and Events Queensland. So we're trying to look at it from all of Queensland perspective, and not trying to narrow it into just one bucket as well, because one of the really interesting things was sort of the focus federally and on the state in terms of innovation and what does that actually mean for the creative industries is it doesn't necessarily mean art and storytelling as we thought of it. And given games has fallen into our pile of people, like, well, you guys are the games people, and we're like, oh, we're not thinking about games. It's really important, I think, and one of the things I've learned is games is not just, narrative or screen stories, even just what one might traditionally be playing games. It's the whole side of serious games and how business utilize games and so on. And so we really understand, we're starting to understand the broadness of that and wanting to make sure whatever we do going forward may mean that we have to work with multiple departments to really pull together something that's impactful for more than just what would, I think, fit within arts.
One of the great things about the fact that there's been so much success in other states is you can actually learn from the things that didn't work. Mm-hmm. I think splintering games and interactive, potentially was a big mistake.
That's interesting.
Well, certainly wasn't one of the funds spent.
Yes.
Interactive means things that aren't games.
Yes.
Where you pushed a button, so you had to pretend that it wasn't a game.
Yeah.
There
were lessons that can be learned, definitely. And not just funding things for money, games that are engineered purely for money. Like, if you're seriously about innovation, then that stuff is going to look weird at the very beginning.
Yeah.
You don't know if it's going to work or not.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I have to say, FilmVic does a lot of stuff where I think it's mostly grants, there's no investment. Our government takes a very different perspective on that. One of the great things about actually sometimes taking an investment position is that if there's a return, it goes back into the industry. It's not profit that we sit on, actually is reinvested in new things. And so, we're thinking about what might be meaningful in that space. And there'll be times where people may say, well, actually what we want to do, we don't want you in. And that's perfectly fine. And that works for us in other parts of the screen industries that we support as well. There are times where we're not involved. And we see that as a great thing. That when our money is needed and where it can make meaningful change, where it can help companies grow or take risks that they otherwise couldn't take, then that's good spend of money. And it doesn't always mean a return either. Sometimes we take risks on things because we can see that it's going to offer a career trajectory that otherwise isn't going to happen. And we see that it's equally of value as commercial or cultural outcome.
So we have a really good cross-section of the industry in the panel right now. We have Meg, you are representing basically a bootstrapping indie. You've got a big project, your biggest one yet, that's on the way. Mark, the manager of Sponge, you have had a tremendous hit very, very recently. Was it 10 million downloads of Fanny Brothers?
Is that 11 yet?
I think we're close.
I think we're almost just about 11.
That's pretty good.
We'll follow you on that.
We'll tweet that one out.
Yes.
Christy, you have worked as a designer. You've done a lot of like not-for-profit stuff. You've done a lot of you're doing some of the most interesting academic work in Australian games at the moment. Morgan is defiant. Everyone should know. You've got Skisavari and Hand Fate, so Defiant is in a really good position these days. That's really good. John has done most things with the industry. I was trying to work out what level of industry experience we've got here. I think it's something about 140 years worth of this, but it's all in you. I stopped counting. But now you're also just a solo dev making games with your kids,
yes.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah,
and then, so Cheryl, a lot of previous experience, you made some Batman games.
I didn't.
Oh.
No, we're part of our team did. I only had DMC Devil May Cry.
Yes.
Oh.
That's pretty good. But now you're wanting to do indie development, but for consoles, and which is something that we've not had terribly much of for a while.
Yeah, absolutely. Consoles are background. It's what we know, and it's mobile. Whoever does that, full respect to you guys. Managing analytics and user acquisition, whatever terms I don't know that I've just said. that's a whole different battlefield to us. And it's being a console, that's where we're at, that's where all of our background is. We're going to try and make it continue.
Excellent. And Paul, of course, you've got your family still working on now the console release for Ninja Pizza Girl, which is very, very cool. And so you have, everyone here is representing a different level of industry involvement, and so it would be kind of nice to run down the panel and just have everyone talk about the kind of funding or the kind of support that would be great specifically for you, if you could, your closest.
Okay, so the project we're working on is currently a $400,000 project. So we are maybe a very small team, but we're building a AAA game right now.
Yeah.
We actually have been lucky enough, unfortunately, to gain some funding. We originally went to Screen Queensland, and unfortunately, just timing, but we are actually going to be taking the game out of the country now, due to an opportunity that we were given at PAX East. So it is not leaving Queensland wasn't something I wanted to do. I've had people down in Victoria go, I just move down, you can move down, have your post address here. But the opportunity that we have right now, we can't even keep the game in Australia right now, and this is for $100,000.
So is that because the money's coming from elsewhere and they want the sort of, I guess, the development production to happen?
So the sorry, that is something a little coy. In contracts at the moment. So it's a new platform that's being started.
Right.
It's an equity funding platform.
Right.
With some new laws that have happened in the state, which means that you can raise up to $1 million twice in a year, in any funding year. We weren't looking for anywhere near that amount. Up to $1 million for us, $100,000 would have got us finish perfectly, but unfortunately the only place, all the rest of the investment, the rest of the $400,000 was all personal investment as well, so the company has taken itself to this point.
Okay.
We've had a large amount of outside media interest. We've had interest from, our game is called Damsel, so that interest has come from that for a reason. We tried to place ourselves in a market that we tried to place ourselves as well to be able to sell the game. But our only way now to complete the game is to start an American company, go offshore with the game.
Yeah. So will you take many people with you, or is it just...
We will, so the game will go, will be created in the States. Will be, a new company will be created under Damsel. But we're working, we're here still.
We're not
leaving, but unfortunately the only way for us to raise. And unfortunately not that much money when it comes to equity. $100,000.
I was going to ask you, at what point did you need that $100,000 in the sort of life cycle of you building the game?
At what point? Well, unfortunately, we let all our contractors go 3 months ago. So pretty much, if we hadn't had the opportunity that came from PAX East, we were going to release the game in its current form. This opportunity has given us the chance to expand what we have, everything that was taken out due to time and money. But then also the opportunities that it kind of will push us into the American market, where we were planning on using some of the marketing money that we could get in Australia to do that. But this opportunity, it's sort of come to a point where we couldn't say no to the idea of it.
So going forward, let's say it's a different game, so forget about Damsel, sorry, it's, I don't know, something else. I guess so that this wouldn't happen next time around, at what point would you want to enter into sort of an equity discussion? Where would that need to take place in that?
For us, we would have, we came to Screen Queensland just after we had finished our own pre-production. So we had a prototype prototype we were about to get ready to go, to start looking for any other investors, things like that. And that would have been a really good chance for us then to keep it all in Australia and not lose PAX. You know, all the other things that for me not wanting to leave Australia meant. So that's maybe close to 12 months ago now. From in this current project, and it's currently about 2 years. We were definitely putting in our own money for the first year. That's not necessarily something I would have expected an agency if we didn't have that money. But at the point where we could then expand, and as soon as the market started opening up for us, with that expansion, that would have been the best place for us to get and actually be able, because the game's been on hold for almost 3 months as well, because of now having to sort of shut down a little bit.
So Mark, you're in a different position.
Well we're the anomaly in the room. We actually funded ourselves before we started building the game. So development funds, and I think the it was insane 4 months ago. I think from my position, and I don't want to hijack the discussion, because I think most people here are more interested in the development side, but I think there is also a very important side in terms of industry development. Industry development is the thing that's the most interesting to us, and I think looking at the other parties that can be involved in this, I think, you know, Tony would speak to me, Lottie in Victoria played a big role in establishing the games industry down there. It wasn't just from Victoria promoting development costs, and I think the thing that the Victorians beat us at better than anything is self-promotion, promoting themselves, putting themselves out there, putting themselves on the map, working together to promote games. You know, if you look at Queensland in the last sort of 3 or 4 months, I mean, we've probably attracted in excess of 40 million players to our games, and yet what are we doing to use that 40 million audience that we've got now to promote each other's games? You know, we've just seen, you know, every week Queensland has got a game on the front page of the App Store every week this year, I think. It's just been ridiculous. And yet the cross-promotion and the promotion of Queensland as a strong industry just doesn't exist. And like I said, I don't want to hijack that, because I think there's a lot to talk about the development side. But to me, the development side is less important than the industry development. If we can work as a group and a body and a group of companies and promote ourselves together, and get organisations like Screen Queensland and other government departments behind us. I mean, you know, we talk about what the Victorians have done, but Tony and I did spend the best part of $1 million of the Queensland government's money on this industry.
Totally worth it. Worth every penny.
Oh, tell you, I had a good time. But you know, there is a lot of stuff that needs to be done. I think where Victoria did some really good stuff was put some infrastructure in place that enabled the GBAA to grow, that's enabled things like the arcade to get off the ground by having some admin resources, yeah. Having someone that could collate the lists and promote the tweets and get a schedule of all the games that are coming out, you know, and that's stuff that's very hard to do. And you know, we're probably, as an organisation, in a position now where we could lead some of that, but the minute we're about to launch another game, or the minute our next game doesn't do very well, or whatever happens, we just stop doing it and all that goes down the chute. Whereas if there's a government person like a champion and people like that to pick that up and keep that going all the time, you know, we could publish games as Queensland. I mean, I use that term very loosely. I mean, but our audience right now is just so large. The you know, development funds would become not a problem.
Right. Well, see, and you know? Actually, you're not hijacking it at all, in fact, because, you know, ultimately, the best thing in the world is if we didn't need to exist for any screen industry, right? If everyone was making enough money, you're able to invest in your own stuff, and or you've got, like, a little angel investors or equity investors that's lining up and you don't need us, that's great. Where we do want to play a role is where we're needed and where we can add value. And absolutely, we do. One of the big things we've had to do is bring film and television industry together to be collaborative, because it really was a big fight between everyone 2 years ago. And if that's where we can add value and that's where we can make a real difference, then I think that's a really key thing for us to
protect. And, you know, the GDA, and I'll put my hand up, I'm certainly, the words Victorian-centric and GDAA have certainly come out of my mouth, and I'm sure they come out of everybody about here. But the bottom line is, the Victorian government and the Victorian industry supports the GDAA a hell of a lot more than Queensland's ever done so. And, you know, we've got to start to pull our own weight. And that's government bodies and funds, but it's also us as an industry. And I would hate to see us follow what was a terrible model of film 15 years ago, where we sit here and say, well, if the government will fund us, we can make great product.
Right.
Well, if we need government's funding to make great product, we should all get out of the industry. You know, this is a support network that can sit back and support us and help us go forward, but we've got to pull our own weight, we've got to stand up together. And, you know, if I hear one more thing about how wonderful the Victorian games industry is, it's just going to, crazy. Poor Nate has to sit next to me and I'll whinge about it all day. Because there's nothing they're doing down there that we're not doing up here, we just don't tell anybody. And we've got to stop doing it. So I think industry development is something that, and I think infrastructure and just helping us and putting the sharp edge on the end of that is a role that Screen Queensland can play really well for us. So that's where we sit.
Thank you very much for that. That was worthwhile. You can go home now.
I go home.
Yeah. Christy, you wear a number of hats. Do you want to break this question up into, you know, as far as your role with SAE, with, you know, even just the kind of event stuff you want to focus on? Like, what do you think would benefit you most?
Well, I can talk about the funding for me. I think, is it James? You're the number one today, aren't you, on the App Store? For me, one of them is a screen culture angle. So that's a big thing, and that's one of the things that it's doing in Melbourne, and then, you know, a lot of people do here. And so I'd be interested in an event which is interstate and international. And so the audience would not just be benefiting Queenslanders, but it would be benefiting Australians and internationals. And so we pitched at that level. And it would be one that's focusing on what success really means in terms of the techniques beyond addiction mechanics.
Okay.
You know, to sort of a whole different levels there. So there's sort of large scale, and I think in the screen culture one, you did talk about benefiting Queenslanders, but you're open to interstate and international.
So our screen culture, we do support, so that's a good example, the Australian Documentary Conference, Screen Producers Association Conference. We support
necessarily, you know, some of those things don't even happen in Queensland, but through some funding, it provides an opportunity for Queenslanders. So it doesn't have to be just something that benefits only Queensland, and we put the sort of wall up at the border. We're a no wall organisation. And, but, you know, we want the benefit to the people who are the taxpayers of the state, because that's where the funding comes from. And but that doesn't work in isolation, because obviously interacting with people from other states and internationally benefits people here. So
yeah, that's good. And the other one is I'm currently working on a project in partnership with people in Sydney, and it's a game and a film. Short film. And so in terms of, for instance, Screen Australia's multi-platform fund could do the short film but not the game. Mm-hmm. And so yeah. And so this is this thing of like, and you know, how would that work with
Screen Australia? We don't have that problem.
Yeah, we don't have that problem.
Yeah.
which was exactly why we did take away those false walls, mm-hmm. because it just prevented people from being innovative and interesting about how they reach their audience. I think there's such an interesting space for people to be playing inside of, in, you know, where all these things meet and where you can find audiences and grow audiences. I mean, you know, people are looking for new audiences all the time and how to engage new audiences, and you know, games are reaching audiences that films are not, then why not sort of take the people who are over here and vice versa, and I just kind of think that that's why we decided to collapse the walls between that, so we wouldn't have that problem.
Yeah, that's great. And I guess, you know, part of the issue is the state that it needs to be in order to get the funding. Obviously, with a short film, we've got a script, and that's a known entity in terms of documentation. With the game, you know, currently you ask for, what is it, market attachment letter, which is not something that we would have that early on, you know, or necessarily want.
Yes.
That early on. So I think you're revising, you know, perhaps that stipulation for things.
We also have an innovative fund, which looks at things that don't fit, I guess, anything that fit anywhere at the moment, and that can genuinely show that they're worth some investment in terms of developing something that looks like it may have potential.
Yeah, I should have mentioned that in the roundup. I forgot about that, sorry. we fund up to $10,000 for things that don't fit anywhere, that we kind of describe as, I don't know what it is yet, you have to tell me.
And that's it. Yeah.
I'm going to be a deal.
I've got at least four.
But it also doesn't, you know, it's just, really describe what innovation is, can you?
Yeah.
What is an innovative project?
Well, Webster's describes it.
So there is some support there, but also another thing to say, and this is important, is that we have guidelines, and they are guidelines and not rules. And it's kind of like they're there, obviously, to make sure that we do create that level of playing field and create fairness, and also just create some sensible parameters around what we're able to do. Mm-hmm. But obviously, if something is fantastic and it's kind of taking things in a great new direction, and it's building terrific talent, and it's building potentially building a business in the state, or you know, it's creatively fantastic, then we're not looking for ways to not do it.
Yeah.
We're looking for ways to do it.
Do you use external assessments?
We do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's another good point. You know, up until last year, we didn't even have Netflix in Australia. Like, the model and the innovation and what's happening in the world of content creation and ways people consume it, you know, Apple Watch was last year as well, like, in terms of...
So much.
Yeah, so much. you know, so we acknowledge that, you know, having guidelines, there will be things that come through, you know, this year, next year, that we didn't think of when those guidelines were written. Mm-hmm. And, you know, and we accept that. And so that's why, you know, we have space and flexibility to, we want to see what's next and be part of it.
Well, put my other hat on, and I'll just mention one other one. As an advocate for students, you know, a healthy ecology means lots of different angles.
Yes.
As the Australian Council used to have, I think, Art Start or that sort of fund of students just graduated, they could apply for $5,000 or $10,000, I think it was, just to make something. So in other words, you don't have the credits yet. And so I think, you know, there's also that potential angle of just a small line of funds for people who have just graduated, especially because a lot of them are looking at being indies now, you know, rather than being employees. That's another potential area that could benefit.
So Morgan, how do you think that Screen Queensland could best support you and Defiant?
So I kind of don't care about Defiant, ultimately. I would hate to see us leaning heavily on Screen Queensland.
Yeah.
We're a great business, we pay our own way. There's a few things though that I think are really important, and for me it all comes down to ecosystem, which kind of touches on what Christy was saying in terms of ecology and what Mark was saying in terms of the overall audience. It's about helping us to have a more robust ecosystem in Brisbane. We know that we got to where we were through a combination of fortune, assistance, mentoring, good timing and good placement. It's really good to hear Screen Queensland speaking about audience, because I don't know what the audience is of the kind of traditional screen business in Australia, but like we've got 100 million players in our audience. Mark's got another 10 million. In the room, we've got nearly 200 million people in the audience.
That's small. Watch traditional television every year in Australia.
So on some, we've got great reach in terms of our ability to particularly as an export business. I think one of the things that's important is that in some places the games industry looks like film, and certainly, you know, I've spent enough time, I was on the Screen Producers Council, spent enough time in that world, I know how to, you know, wear the outfit and look like I might be a screen producer. And our business looks screen producer-ish. In this room are fantastic businesses that are self-publishing focused, that have no relationship. They don't understand markets, they don't have markets, they are self-publishing to international platforms and getting, you know, enormous successes from those. So for me to build the ecosystem, we need to do a few things. And the biggest thing for me is to best understand what a Screen Queensland win looks like. Mm-hmm. Like what makes you ecstatic with what you've achieved in the game sector in a year's time?
It would be audience.
Yep.
It would be, you know, we, in terms of investing in sort of that early stage stuff, we would actually be seeing it actually become a finished product that launches. It sounds crazy, but that's a success, but it actually, you know, there's a lot of ideas obviously that get generated and get worked on, but it's actually seeing them through to actually reach audience. Things that actually make money, they're really big things for us too. Things that win awards are really big things for us because they're things that we can celebrate as, you know, as a state or as a government who's put that money out there. They want to celebrate the successes of how that money's being used and see a benefit, as I say, back to the taxpayers of Queensland. And that doesn't mean the taxpayers getting all their money back, but what it means is that, you know, we take a lot of pride in, you know, our success stories.
Yeah.
And it's been able to have success stories that come out of this funding, whether that's in reaching large audiences, whether that's in building up your company and like going from 2 employees to 4 employees, that's a success story for us. So it is that there's a whole gamut of things. There's no one thing that is going to tick our boxes. It's how do we see this, you know, you guys grow as an industry and become more successful, you know, financially in terms of audience, in terms of reach, in terms of recognition. That's what we're looking for.
And I think from our perspective, that's exactly our goals too, and that's where like a robust ecosystem really helps propel that forward. And the other thing is this huge bang for buck, I think, for small developers. There's an enormous amount of leverage that very small amounts of money have early in the process. And again, that's why I don't really talk about what Defiant needs in these situations.
because, you know, the big difference for us is we got a $50,000 digital ignition grant back when that was a thing that happened. And they gave us that money technically to build a prototype, and we shipped a game. And they were like, we expect that. We don't know where the next $50,000 is coming from, so let's, you know. And that worked exceptionally well for us, and that really kickstarted our business. And we have 20 people on the back of that, and I see the influence of, not to suggest to anybody that $50,000 is a small amount of money, like, if that's your dinner bill, then that is an enormous amount of money. Take the check back, that is not right. But for a company of a few people, that amount of money makes a world of difference.
One point you made, which I think, just looking at funding specifically, you talked about, you know, a lot of these guys are self-publishing onto international platforms.
Yeah.
Localization is probably an area that you wouldn't necessarily look in film, but it can be very important for stuff like if I was to look at our games and where we sit in the world, what would I like assistance with? Some bandwidth and some money to help me just hit localization so I can look at some of the markets that don't spring up enough to sort of warrant me moving guys around and taking away from our day-to-day development, but probably produce a nice little side income. And having something that helped me nudge me towards doing those things would be something that makes sense to me. And I think for a lot of the guys out there who are doing stuff, I mean, James is another good example. You know, he could go ballistic all around the place tomorrow, and having some funds to stick in there to localise in certain markets could really help him capitalise very quickly.
We're a fantastic export business.
How do you define side income versus the main income, right? China's Chinese global market is number one in the world, and India is becoming number two.
Yep.
So without localization, you will not be able to.
And you make such a fraction of your money there without localizing that warranting localizing becomes difficult.
Yeah.
You know, and it, like for us, you know, we've gone from a position of 6 months ago where we did things that we could afford to do. Now we do things we've got time to do. And localization, like our technical guy Matt's here, he bags on to me about localization all the time, but I just can't afford, or I just can't find the bandwidth to move someone from here to there right now. And you know, bottom line is we're probably leaving money on the table. But it's scary as you're going through the growth pains, as a lot of the smaller indies will go through as they find success, to actually take your eye off the ball that you're looking at, to look over here. Because, you know, we have bugs, we have updates, we have other things that we've got to sort out. To put something in a rush is not easy for me to just do.
And that touches on the easy wins part of this.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there are easy wins.
Absolutely.
When somebody's at has hit, you know, number one best new game in the US, that's a success. And there's an easy magnifiable effect of that success.
And if we go straight in and make that, put that into Russian and French and all that sort of stuff, Apple have that on their app stores a month later. Absolutely. But you know, hopefully James is going to run off his feet in the next month. and finding the opportunity to do that, it will be a challenge.
You mentioned mentoring too. Is that something that happens much at the moment?
Look, I hope so. I'm trying to be active and
Morgan's the worst person to answer this question. So Brisbane, Morgan is most people that I know and he is the mentor. So we've been over 6 years now, and we would not have, if it wasn't for Morgan and Dan, whether it be advice, from should we keep going? We've asked that advice. We've asked for the mentoring on the game. But so many people in Brisbane know Morgan. Know probably a few of the other people sitting on this because they're. I think mentoring has been the strongest thing that we've been able to do in Brisbane without funding at the moment because it's kept people. There's a reason that people know each other. But also Morgan has been. I'd say, if not a personal mentor, then definitely a professional, giving advice a lot. So, it definitely has been a major part of our company continuing
It's probably way too informal. I mean, the bottom line is We've got some amazingly experienced and talented people in this industry, and a good portion of them really are lost in the industry these days. And if we were to, this comes back to industry development to me, you know, if we were able to, you know, encourage, set up an infrastructure where those mentors were, it was more formal, I think it would be better. I think it works. I mean, like, you know, John Passfield and Morgan, that's so much of this industry, it's more funny.
But it's happening. Like, that's the other thing, as you look at the younger people who are coming into the industry.
And also, we can't expect them to give up of their time necessarily freely, but also, it's not that I think John and Morgan want to be paid for mentoring, but they can't have 126 people bring them up for mentoring. All due respect to both of them, they're not the only ones. There's plenty of people around that should be and could be offering the support, and I'd hate every one of these people to pick up Morgan's phone tomorrow. But hey, you're a good mentor, can I get on board?
But I'm wearing the one today.
We do it well, but we do it informally and haphazardly. We should be doing it much more professionally with a much more, again, pointy edge. And I think the get that pointy edge on the front of the industry is where I think government could do a lot.
It's also one thing that we've been extremely trying to push with the Brisbane Women in Games group. We've been doing a lot of, and it's just been that it hasn't necessarily been to try and build the industry at the moment. It's been more of a helping people who are coming out as students who don't necessarily know people. That's where it really came from. But we've been doing AMAs with some of the more knowledgeable people in the industry, just on Facebook, within that personal group. So I think the mentoring, trying to bring out the people, and because on that group particularly, a lot of people maybe aren't necessarily the ones who are going to say, yeah, I'll do an AMA today. So bringing out those mentors and introducing them to the younger students who are on the Facebook group, and then we do have meetups as well, but really trying to pull out those people from within the bigger industry groups as well. And it's only a women's group, but I definitely see the unity groups as well. There's people leading and trying to really pull people forward and pull out the mentors within those groups. So I think it's definitely important to find.
Like I said, it almost comes back to list keeping. Who's the keeper of the knowledge that we can impart on everybody out there? And I think that's what we lack. I mean, it's informal, it works well in a small group of people. Yep. But, you know, we've said before, this is a great turnout, and it is, but it probably only represents a third of the people out there doing the stuff. Are the other two-thirds aware of what's going on? Is there a resource for them to go and find out who can help them, who they can talk to, and who's willing to give up their time?
Can I just say something at this point? It's so amazing, actually, hearing you talk, just in terms of how well you've supported. I mean, walking into this sort of very, very fresh, it's incredible how you supported one another, how you've been mentoring each other, how, you know, you've made things work.
We all come from four companies in 4 units.
Yeah.
it's
really great, and it kind of genuinely feels like there's something that's very, very solid there to build on, and very positive to work with.
We're just informal. We don't spruik ourselves well enough. And like I said, it's just that infrastructure. It's just getting that. And the Vicks did a really good job probably 6 or 7 years ago of laying that infrastructure and then getting support on the ground and being able to build that stuff so that it was.
I thought we weren't mentioning
them. You've got to learn from them. I mean, I hate to be choice more than anybody, but. He's always an honorary Queenslander when he's in Queensland. But we've got to learn from what they've done well. And to me, really, their success has been more about the infrastructure than they've outlaid and the development funds they've given out. I don't know, would you agree with that, Tony?
It's important. But
I'm not saying the other's not important, but we always hear about them giving money, they've done this, they've done that. It's the infrastructure that's allowed that to be successful, that is where that's been successful.
It's important to talk about time. I think, nobody expects, a lot of what became visible after
10 years or more of consistent support. So it doesn't all happen overnight. There's opportunity, meets timing, meets consistency. And I think we're really well placed for the consistency side of it. You know, there's, as you say, there's good harmony.
We are starting to run a little bit out of time, but I just want to grab some final comments from the end of the table.
Actually, one of the things I would like, I think it's really important, I think Mark's touched on, I think promotional stuff's really important for me. I'm a big fan of getting the word out there. And I do cringe, Tony, whenever I see games in a sniffing the top 10. And that's not your fault, but it's great what's done, because you get ministers talking about success. You know, gaming in the top 10 in the App Store. And I always get very sad when I see, you know, like Astro Attacks there, or Steady Pants is half made in Brisbane. And there's no one to champion up. So we've got a Queensland Games Twitter handle that probably trying to build up. There's a number of people here who tweet out about it.
What is it?
It's called Queensland QLD Games. They follow at QLD Games. And the idea with the people who administer it is only tweet about news, so you don't want to be just not, you know, it's news and release about games made in Queensland from far north down to here. So that's one thing I think is really important and talk about that. The other one is I ran by Pearl Studios, which is a startup accelerator. And one thing, I talked to Dena about this, it's this strange thing I found with the spaces in Brisbane that are startup spaces, you can go in and set up a studio, but it's like oil and water when it comes to startup people and game developers. They don't mix. It's I think you need a very different supporting environment. I don't know what that is. I'm still trying to work that out. I think it could be the programmer, or it could be that we're out to, what's our exit? That's kind of the strategy when you're in a startup accelerator. It's our exit, is we're gonna hit this, make this out, sell out. And games is a mixture of art and a mixture of a startup mentality and programming and production and writing and storytelling. So it's a very different beast. So I saw, you know, right, Pedal was under the umbrella of Privacy Labs, so I saw the amount of support that was given from the labs to keep that running. It was, you know, we had people doing the marketing side of things, somebody handling the administration. So there's a lot of work there. I know Dan's got Game Space going now, and he probably appreciates what work is needed to run that. So that's something that, you know, assistance or help there would be wonderful. Because I think a lot did come out of right, Pedal, even though people didn't mix that well with the other non games people, but we saw a lot of collaboration. You know, James was there, we had Benning Games, Sarah's, he was there. There's a lot of collaboration and talking and even mixing. There was a little bit of bleed through to the startups, but not that much. But there was a lot of sharing in all the space, and that's great to have that one place to go to and people can hang out. So I guess my thing would be just some sort of assistance in helping that grow. So there's a lot of work involved in sort of in creating those spaces. And I think, sadly, game developers are like oil to water. They do want their own space. Again, I'm sure Tony would know more about that. But I've seen firsthand with putting those two together, it just doesn't work. So that's my piece.
Cheryl?
Okay. So we basically, and this came back about a year and a half ago now, we took what was a more traditional approach, and we sought full project funding rather than fund part ourselves, et cetera. So our funding is coming in internationally. Full project funding for console games is not a small amount of money. So, you know, that obviously ideal would be if we could get large amounts of funding, that would be amazing. But at the time, I'm not sure if that would have been available to us if we reached out and talked first. But, you know, we are where we are. Next time around, it would be amazing though if we could keep that internally rather than go overseas for that money. So that's,
I'm not being rude, but you know, you sort of talk about funding. Can you give me some parameters?
So technically not. Let's just say technically not. Sorry, NDA. I know. Most of the console games that are slightly higher are going to be millions or more, though.
Okay.
So, so we went that route and it paid off, which was good. That's allowed us to bring in, money from overseas that wasn't here before as well too, which is also nice to bring in. Three full-time people we have. We're working with 8 people, part-time retainers, ongoing work. Only one of those is overseas. The other 7 have been brought in here locally, so that's been good for us. where the help really comes in would be, God, if we could get more money to help support those new salaries and those people that we've created jobs for, to turn them into full-time roles rather than part-time and retainer roles, that would be wonderful. There's that side of it. There's, you know, again, staffing support for juniors and for mentoring. For us, it's not a short-term thing. It's, you need somebody for 6 months to a year to train up and mold into somebody that's going to be really valuable. But that time is not just the junior getting caught up, it's also the time you can lose of a senior person taking that time to work with them. So, you know, it's that head bringing somebody in is much bigger than it seems, especially when you have three full-time people to do that. We'd be losing one person full-time. So that mentoring isn't just the cost of the junior coming in. There's also, you know, from what I saw, GDC again from fresh eyes, having gone for the first time, the biggest shock, and I think I know I expressed this when we talked about it within the group internally before we came here, was seeing places like Mexico have been set up for the game development. You know, that was amazing, and yet it's not a place that really pinged on my radar as being a big game development area. And yet we couldn't get an Australian booth or a Queensland booth or whatever that might be. Now, there isn't specifically a Victorian booth there either, I realize this, so I'm not. But you know, again,
there was.
Was there? Oh god. Anyway,
my
obviously
did.
It wasn't very good. I'm like, fine. I'm like, so, you know, things like that would be really good to give you that exposure, because I don't know about mobile and those things, but for console, GDC, and there's a couple of others, are going to be the biggest places to get coverage and get exposure for us anywhere in the world, especially because, you know, the short of it is no matter how much exposure I get in Australia, that might be 5% of my overall sales in the world. I need that, but my 95% is somewhere else, and it's generally in the line within Europe and America. So I need to get access to that 95%, and those are the places to do it. Games, GDC, it's PAX. I don't know so much about the PAX over in the US. Maybe you can probably talk more about what the expectation is for PAX in America than I do. But again, and Nicole, you were in the US as well. So there's those things that are where our markets really inherently lie. So yeah, and just in general, a champion to get out there, not just locally, but internationally, that is gonna screen and shout out of Queensland and tying in with the GAA so that we can all screen and shout together about everything, you know, all of our successes as a country around them, having these disparate, you know, states and groups shouting about their successes individually. I'd like to see a bigger voice as Australia again.
So, Nicole, this is one of the shortcomings of being the most polite person. When we do this next time, you will have like an air horn or something. But would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, so we've actually had a lot of help from Screen Queensland. Thank you. Yeah, and I think for us, that did make all the difference. But I think, to me, the stuff that really, really helps is the little stuff, the support stuff. There's always going to be a place for development funding, but stuff like travel and localization, and you know, most of our sales come from Japan, and we wouldn't have access to that as a market if I hadn't physically traveled there.
Yeah.
And a lot of it's already been said, but the infrastructure.
You've got to make it worth the trip from Noosa.
First inaugural was this year.
Yeah. The women are doing really crazy, interesting
so important is most of us came in from, not all of us, but most of us came from larger studios where we had one role, we did one job. I'm currently wearing a hat of many, many different things. And some of these things, I'm doing business. There was somebody else doing that. You know, I'm doing, you know, design. There was somebody else doing that. So that's where that funding like that becomes important to not just women, but all of us, because we've all had to step up and learn a whole bunch of skills and train ourselves, and unfortunately fail at times to do that, to learn. So, you know, that's why it becomes important.
And they also have funding to...
They also have funding to people employee juniors or interns, I think. Yeah, and that would be really helpful too, I think, to both the junior and the company. Excellent,
thank you.
I'm trying to psychically forget. Sorry, I'm her other half. Oh, no. Sort of. It's really right. I just think another one of those small costs which hits a lot of small people is legal.
Yeah.
It's just a bastard of a cost. Especially when you're starting off, you've got your, you know, scrupulously saved $6,000 that you're going to make in the next game, and, you know, the accountant takes all of that.
And the lawyer takes the rest.
And the lawyer takes the rest. Well, he sues you. So, yeah, I just wanted to add that to the things that Nicole was saying, is that travel is huge, and legals and accounting.
Trademarking as well. Another one that
most
people don't think about,
that
gets very expensive quickly.
Business expenses
that
aren't paying people. Trademark and certification, and, you know, basically any money that goes out of a small indie developer is bad. Like, so salaries are okay, and there's lots of ways you can mitigate that, and there's often sweat equity involved, and all those sorts of things. And not eating very well, and, you know, white funding, which is basically how to find the startup. But yeah, like, that's right. Terrible.
Yeah, that's where I think some sort of fund, and that 10K that you're talking about for the other stuff is a great starting point. But when I sort of, in my head, like, you know, my mom found a top-up fund, you get towards, you know, we've projected our budget for 14 months. And so I, no matter how great I was, our budget is not going to match what I projected for 14 months, you know, this, even with contingency and every other sort of thing out there. And so having some sort of fund towards the end of the project where you can go, great, it's wonderful, we're almost there, oh Jesus, it's almost a really amazing game. Is there something else you can help us, be it localization to another language was mentioned as well too. Possibly getting somebody in to do a nice animated intro rather than an in-game one that would target up that little bit more, and that's especially, say, for Japanese audiences, they love animated intros. This is a number of things like that at the end of a life cycle that we all just suddenly go, holy crap, I didn't expect that.
Small amounts of money help at the end of more in games, I think, than with prototype funding at the beginning.
Great. So, you've all been really, really patient, and I know that because I've been standing here for like the last 2 hours. So that's a long time. We might open it up to some questions from the audience. So, yes, how are we doing this? We did not work out the logistics of questions right at all.
You can repeat the question.
Points have been made already, just trenchant, and I just want to plus one all of them. One thing I would say is that Cheryl's point about the number of hats you wear, my little studio, I've been employing half a dozen Queenslanders for the last wee while. Some of them would have otherwise been working in shoe stores or making falafels. It's just great to see those students coming out of their degrees and coming down to work for me, doing what they trained to do. It's very exciting. It's also very frustrating because at my point with Cheryl's thing about the many hats is that on a Sunday night, I'm paying their invoices, and then Monday morning checking my email to see if my Ignite Queensland funding applications come through, and there's someone from the Queensland government who's rocking up at 10 a.m. to check their inbox. I've been working a 60, 70 hour week, and you know, they're trying to get through whatever process it is that they have for their administration. It would just be great to see, you know, Screen Queensland and other agencies that are dealing with people who have a startup mentality, who have a creative studio mentality, trying to get on board with how we do what we do every week. And we just do not have time to fill out applications. It would be great for you guys to be publishing your email addresses, potentially even your Twitter handles, on those web pages so that we can reach out to you directly, digitally, and just engage with you instantly in the way that we need to get what we're trying to do done 24/7. Because it's just so time consuming, and any hour that I invest is coming out of me maybe integrating the social sharing in my game or some other vital ingredient. Yeah, so I hope that helps us. I mean, trying to be constructive and very tired.
Could I just answer by saying that we certainly don't have a 9-to-5 team at Spring Queensland.
That's got to go.
Yeah. Oh, isn't that so, and almost all of us actually come from the screen industry, and many of us are used to working in before I came into a job working on government side, I was working in sort of little indie film companies in the UK. So I feel your pain, but also I kind of know exactly what you've got to do to make those kinds of businesses work. You know, at the same time, I'm not going to say we're available 24/7 to answer emails at 2 o'clock in the morning, but our email addresses are available, and you know, we'll always kind of have those conversations with you in that way. The application forms, yes, they're a pain. They have to be there to a certain extent, but we are looking at ways that kind of streamline this down so that we've got what we need, so that we can report properly. Because it's taxpayers' money, and we have got to report properly. But we are looking at ways of streamlining all of that kind of applications process. But as I said, if you want to kind of have a conversation by email, by phone, in person, over coffee, though you probably haven't the time, there's always, you know, we are very, very open to working in that way and genuinely kind of do know where you're coming from.
Can I say, I think your application forms are genuinely appropriate to the amount of money involved for each type. It's just hard for us because most developers have to sit there with like a Klingon to English dictionary and try and like call somebody up and be like, has anybody ever written one of these things before? What am I going to do there?
We hear that. We will change that. Yeah. Without a doubt, that is, it will be a direct outcome. They're going to change.
The paperwork's always easier than you think. I think a lot of people have this notion that government paperwork is onerous and crazy, and in some instances it is.
So, you worked in government. So
well, I dare say I've written more government grants than anybody in this room. And you know, I guess one of the things that you've got to come to realise is that if you want support and to work with the government, you need to be prepared to get and do it in their terms. And you know, sometimes it's easy to think that there's this person that didn't come into work at 10 o'clock. Screen Queensland, fortunately, are a fairly autonomous body, so they're a little bit better. You get into some of the other government departments, you need 8 people to sign off on a $10,000 payment. It's not one person who rocked in at 10 o'clock. It's you've got to start this chain, and it gets sent back, and it goes forward, and you've got to kind of understand. And if you're not kind of prepared to understand how government works, then it's not going to work for you. You've got to work with them. But, you know, talk to them, I guess, is the one thing. You know, I wrote grants for the government for 10 years and for companies. And, you know, the closing date would be on the Thursday, and they would ring me on the Wednesday night and say, I want to put my grant in tomorrow, can you have a look at it? And I'm like, I've got 15 grants I'm looking at for people I've been talking to for 6 months, and you want me to drop them and work with you? You know, it's kind of, you've got to be in touch and be talking to these people. I mean, Tony never stops talking to the government. do you? If you think you can, it's almost like it's a 365 day a week conversation to get whatever you want. If you wake up one morning and think I'm going to get government funding today, it's not going to happen.
I just want to add to that too, just to explain a little bit about Screen Queensland and our structure too. So Screen Queensland is a government-owned company, but we have a board appointed by the government, so we're actually arm's length. We moved out of our bureaucratic offices in George Street into the London offices in Newstead, which is an amazing creative space and all other creative things. Our doors are open. People come and use our offices to do everything from meetings to castings to storyboarding, what have you. Like it's we want to have that relationship with industry that, you know, is interactive. And one of the cool things about having moved and doing that and having things like parking where you don't have to pay $75 in the city is that, you know, people actually come in and run into other people from the industry, and so there's other conversations other than just with us happening. In terms of our processes, I would love to not work a 60-70 hour week. I literally have that every day of my life too. So we get it, like that's the business we're into because we're in the creative industry and we're working with filmmakers who are on set. I mean, my week this week, I went down for the first day of shooting at Marvel and we had an event there at 6:30 in the morning. I was out the door at 5 a.m. on Monday morning. I'm still here at whatever time on Friday night. Like that is, four of our team are here tonight. Like that is what we do. And we are very responsive in that way. Where it does come to conversations, where, as Joe said, we're very willing to have conversations very early, whether it's about just understanding who we are, wanting to have a face that you know who to talk to, whether it's an idea about something, whether it's something that's progressing, and then it gets into a more detailed conversation. That can be done by phone, it can be done by email, it can be done in person. You know, the other thing about moving out of George Street is our staff mostly have cars and can get to people. So we're not stuck in an office where you've got to come to us as well. So we're very willing to come and see you wherever you are, including Noosa.
on a Friday.
Give you a call in a sec.
Okay.
And I think you've got to remember too, these guys that handle the grants, they'll spend more time on the grant than the applicant will. And so yeah, they really are trying to get it out the door. They don't want to spend 3 weeks on an application that gets knocked back any more than you want it. And you know, again, it's understanding that they're actually on your side, and the more time and effort. And again, I'll say we for a minute because I just want to. We're only human too. It's, if you see a half-assed, pardon the language, application hit your desk, and you've got ones that people have put 6 or 7 weeks into, you don't put the time into them either. Like, you know, you've got to make it look like you're actually serious about this and putting it in. And I'm not saying there's anyone here that's not, but you've just got to, I think sometimes we're very quick to be adversarial about the government and instead of, in the most cases, I mean, I don't work anymore because it's a crazy place to work. I'm finding myself defending the public service, which is you know what I mean?
They hurt your family.
Yeah. I'm going to sack this on a bit.
Oh, sorry, I just wanted to add that too. One of the things we've also done is we've moved to Smarty Grants as an online application. For so you can save as you go, which means you can, if you run into things that are a problem, you can call us. We don't get it till it's finished. We just know that someone started something. Some of those never come to us. But it is, you know, it is there. You can start on it. If you run into problems, you have that conversation with us. Just don't do it the day before.
One thing that would be super nice, and I don't know if this is practical in any way, shape, or form, but is if there were successful applications that were able to be circulated to people as examples of successful applications with, you know, potentially confidential information filed off them. But I often send the applications around to people because having been on the other side as an assessor, you know, there is a broad range, and you look at the ones that are potentially up to funding versus the gap to others, and like these people need to see this one to understand where that gap is and what they should be aiming for in terms of polish and professionalism.
I don't think so.
We might have to make some up.
Yeah. That could be a thing.
Yeah.
We could potentially make some up, yeah.
Should we now have a rebuttal from Victoria?
So it's Tracy, actually just picking up on a point you just made, not a rebuttal at all.
When would be a free board position for Screen Queensland, and how quickly can we appoint Nicole Stark?
So I have nothing to do with the appointment of the board. It's done by the government. So
when are the positions up for talking about?
So they were appointed. The current board that we have is appointed for a 3-year term last July. So it's been a year. So they've got 2 more years to go. But having said that, like, it doesn't mean that they can't add some additional people to the board. And so if there are people with particular skills that would be, you know, for this industry, I'd be happy for you to email me, then I'm happy to communicate that on the chat.
Yeah, sure. We've got time for probably maybe 2 or 3 more before we get thrown out of here bodily, so. Hi guys. Listen, I'm in a bit of an unusual situation because I started a VR-based game company before VR came out, which was questionably intelligent. One of my unfortunate areas, like, I've been thrust into being running an independent company and I've been learning a lot of things. One of my major skill failures is reaching out to institutions and asking for things. And I tried to approach Screen Queensland back when I was working on a hoverboard simulator, of all things. The problem I ran into was I couldn't communicate my ideas and my product to you, essentially. There was this gap in both channels of communication. I didn't know how to translate my stuff into Screen Talk, and then the information that was provided to me was in screen format. Is there any way we can help? Like, I might be the worst person to actually try and help, but that was the wall I ran into. It wasn't that you guys weren't approachable. I was talking to Kieran. My name's also Kieran, which is very confusing. But like, it was really easy to get in touch with you. It was just the information on both sides. We were speaking different languages, and we couldn't help each other in that situation. Granted, that's several years ago, but how do we move past that? Because that was what stopped me.
But this conversation is really about beginning to understand how we can move past it, you know, and just kind of trying to, you know, in simple things like having people who have these expertise look over and who are working in this industry look over our guidelines and tell us, oh, well, what's that? And we'll say, well, it's this. You know, they'll go, well, actually, in our world, this means that. So, and I think that beginning to have those conversations will really help. And, you know, also, you know, we do have people who we are in now bringing into our, and we've always had external assessors who have been drawn from your peer group. So from that point of view, if you get to the point of actually putting in an application, it's sort of looked after to a certain extent through those external assessors who kind of do speak your language and do understand exactly what you're trying to say about your product. But ahead of that time, I think, you know, what we're trying to do now is say, well, look, let's kind of just be open book about it and go, well, you can see our guidelines. What don't you understand? What don't you get? And I think in having those conversations and, you know, and if there is things which are specific, I think, you know, just trying to kind of work those things through without removing all kind of conversation about funding and guidelines and process. Actually, sometimes it's just about sitting down with somebody and going, oh, so what do you do? Like, as if you were humans at, say, a drinker's party. But I think it's probably, even from that time period, we've probably come a long way as well. I mean, having done a VR initiative just as an example, and actually we have all of that technology in our office now as well. We have a Vive, and binoculars about to arrive, we've got, you know, the Samsung Galaxy stuff and what have you. So even in terms of the education of our own team, we've been very focused on that for really the last 12 months. And so that conversation that you had then is probably going to, would even be different today, just in terms of our own knowledge and understanding and our actual passion to move into these areas.
We're all going to GDC.
Yeah,
we're all going to. Hey guys, So Mark mentioned earlier the cost behind localization. One other cheeky cost that kind of sneaks up that more affects console devs is ratings. And you can expect, depending on how many sales regions that you're trying to reach out to, you can expect for, I know, it's varied, but you can think maybe it's about between $5,000 to $8,000 just to get a rating so you can sell your game in that region. A second thing as well is, Tracy, you mentioned, you know, you didn't know what GDC was until you went there. Another kind of like thing that is part of the ecology that Morgan was kind of talking about earlier is something that's very unique to the games industry, and they're called game jams. And so game jams are basically, if you think of like music jams, where people from different kind of, like you got your piano player, you got your guitar player, et cetera, et cetera. They come together and they jam. A game jam is basically you get programmers, you get your designers, your artists, and they jam and make a game in like 2 days. So that kind of stuff is like kind of understanding what the things that we do in the community is probably helpful for you guys, because someone like me might come up to Joe or Dia and say, hey, I'm wanting to go to a game jam in Norway, and I'm wondering if there's any way we can bridge that gap and send you know, some talented people over there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so ratings and game jams.
Some of that's us too. We should be inviting you, you know, as an industry, in Queensland, we're not particularly organised. We should be inviting you to game jams. The 48-hour game sitcom happens right here.
But that's all this.
Yeah. Well, any of us can.
We should be crashing your events too.
Yeah, you have more.
I see a lot of mingling between documentary
producers.
I do. Yeah,
well, Morgan does. Yeah, I love crashing. Lisa, last year, thanks to that. But,
I think that's a really good point. You know, promoting that idea and really kind of talking to each other and working together. It's not just about Screen Queensland and the industry. I think, you know, if you guys come to our events, we haven't met probably
every other week.
Yeah, I was going to say at least once a month.
Yeah.
And some of them are just networking, and some of them have got sort of a little bit of content in them. But
some of them are about gender, like, and diversity. It's like a full range. Some are about particular broadcasters. Some are about, you know, just there's really the full gamut of stuff that we do. We have not done anything for games, and you know, we'd love to do that.
So where would we hear about this?
So if you sign up to, if you go on our website, homepage, bottom of the website, there's just a little thing that you can sign up to, and you get alerts.
Awesome. Good.
And they'll go up on our Facebook as well, and I think a lot of them are shared on our Twitter.
It is there, is it?
Yeah.
I've got to think of it.
No, it is there. You just sign up on the website. We need to have your permission before we can start spamming you.
I can get one more, and then we'll all get it turned out.
Hey guys, just wondering where funding lies with technology for games, not just a game product, but the technology that helps drive games. I've worked in lots of places around the world, and I can honestly say that a lot of innovation and really innovative tech that supports the game industry comes out of Australia, and Queensland in particular. So how would somebody, if they wanted to pitch, say, a game engine or, you know, a tool or animation pipeline or something that helps other devs, is that possible to get funding for?
So at the moment, that wouldn't fit with us. It would fit with Advanced Queensland, which is a different department. But as part of this whole thing, I think that that's part of our conversation. And certainly where it's something doesn't fit with us, and I know if somewhere else it can go, we'll certainly direct you to the different things that are happening there. But I think what we're trying to do is step back and have a more holistic look at how we support games across the board, including infrastructure. And so, you know, I think that that's part of where we're headed, but at the moment it doesn't fall within our
okay, so what about costs for small developers? license an engine to realise a vision of the game? Is there assistance in that for them?
So can you just explain that a little more? So this is a case in point.
So most people will probably be familiar with Unity as a technology for the game. Mm-hmm. And it's free at the point, but you can't profile in it, you need to go through extra hoops to get the extra functionality. If you want to release on a console, you have to buy a license and you have to pay for the extra plugins to release or to build within those platforms. Mm-hmm. Once you've gone through that hoop of buying it once, if you've got four or five developers, the licensing requirements means that everybody has to buy a copy of that technology. And that's suddenly a spike in costs for a small developer that may not be possible for them.
It's about $2,000 a head as soon as you go pro, and you kind of have to release it commercially,
exactly.
Effectively. So, and you know, what's interesting about that is that I know that the Queensland government has an educational license for Unity. I think they're 45,000 copies that they're licensed. I'm sure they don't pay $2,000 per head. So I think there's opportunities. There's opportunities there from a lot of.
Isn't Unity actually moving to a subscription model now?
But it's a subscription for a minimum of 12 months.
Is it okay? $2,000. Yeah. Because we don't have all. Cool.
To answer that question, traditionally the government generally shies away from contributing to day-to-day costs of a business, and something like a Unity license would be considered day-to-day costs of a business, and generally wouldn't, or traditionally wouldn't be something they would fund. But on the other one, the Queensland government certainly funded game engines previously.
I think what we would probably say is that, as Mark says, we tend not to put money into overheads and day-to-day running costs, but if we're funding a project and that there is an element inside of that project which is critical to the delivery of that project, then obviously, you know, we can look at that slightly differently and
startup situation involved, that could change.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking it's more guidelines for developers to sort of say, I have to build this kind of thing to bring it to my product.
Mm-hmm.
It's more or less the way you're talking about. You're still talking about delivering a product for the game. It's just there's a path we need to get there. Do you know what I mean? It's, for some people, the mental block is, I can't start unless I have this. But knowing that I can amortize the cost for this helps them.
See, this brings back a little bit, it's a discussion I had with Joe about are we seeking funding for a project or are we seeking funding for a business? And if you're seeking funding for a business, I think the government will generally shy away from what you've spoken about. However, if you're seeking funding for a project, and that would be a definable part of the project, then maybe that would become on the table. And I think that becomes a bit of a discussion we had, was what are we funding here? What are we seeking funding for? What is Screen Queensland going to fund?
It's a blurred line. You can't make a game without the software and that runs.
No, you can't. But again, if say a successful company like Defiant was to go to Screen Queensland and ask for funding, I don't think they would be expecting Unity licenses to be included.
Back when we used to do project funding, that's a buzz item. Project funding.
Sure.
You know, so project funding to Screen Australia. They have a budget with 9,000 entries relating to renting cameras that you don't have to fill in, and the one line that actually accounts for your budget, which is staff and software licenses. Between those two, that's a game studio, basically. But you'd expect to see those things on a project funding. But when we were funded as part of the Screen Australia Fund, rest in peace. that was enterprise funding, so they were funding our business, so they were investing in our business, and they weren't really concerned about what we spend it on. That's not entirely true. There's a lot of reporting, but it wasn't. We didn't have to go through and say, well, this is for the vacuum cleaner, this is for the software, this is for that.
We may have to cut you off there, Morgan, because getting some desk chairs from Steve up there, and also I've just lost like three friends in the audience. So,
you will be
available outside. People who still have a few follow-up questions, at least for a little while.
Yeah, sure. And I've got some cards too, so I'm happy to share those.
Fantastic. Yeah,
and if not, you can get us through our website, Facebook or Instagram.
Wonderful. So yeah, if you do still have questions for Screen Queensland, please chase them up.
This isn't the only time.
Exactly. This is the start of the whole conversation. Well, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you guys.